Hello, my name is Sidi. I'm a software engineer on the weather team. And today, I'm here to share with you some exciting updates coming to WeatherKit this year. WeatherKit is powered by the Apple Weather Service. Its easy-to-use privacy-first APIs enable you to provide accurate, hyperlocal weather data. And WeatherKit is not just at the core of our own weather app. Its Swift and REST APIs are used by developers such as Carrot Weather, Not Boring Weather, and DuckDuckGo to deliver critical weather information to their users. This year, we're making WeatherKit better than ever with some great enhancements. First, we're enriching forecasts with details like precipitation amounts and cloud cover by altitude. Then, we're introducing the ability to contextually highlight upcoming weather changes. And finally, we're adding support for a binary format that expedites data transfer. Today, I'll be walking through each of these, including how you can implement them in your app, starting with richer forecast details. WeatherKit is made up of several great APIs. There's availability to tell you which datasets are available for a given location, attribution to give you the data sources to attribute to, and there's active alert to give you details about ongoing severe weather. But the most important of them all is the Weather API. It offers some of the most essential weather data, like current conditions, minute-by-minute precipitation, 10 days worth of hourly and daily forecasts, and weather alerts. And this year, we're making it even better by adding more details to the current, hourly, and daily forecasts. The current conditions provide details about the weather in the moment, like temperature, wind speed, or UV index. And now, you can add even finer details like cloud cover by altitude. We are bringing these enhancements to the hourly forecast as well. You can now complement hourly cloud cover forecast with details like how it varies by altitude, or offer precipitation amount by the hour, just like the Apple Weather app. And the daily forecast query is getting the biggest enhancements of them all. You can now easily add more granular daily forecasts to your apps, like the high and low humidity, or you can even split your forecast by day parts, separating the daytime weather from that of the night. Now, I will show you how you can access hourly precipitation data in your app with an example in Swift. First, I will quickly add an extension on CL location. This makes it easy to refer to New York as our reference location here and in all our upcoming Swift examples. Fetching precipitation data is easy. First, I need to pass in the location for which I want to get the data. Then, what granularity I want from my data. Here, I want the hourly, so I specify the that hourly query. Finally, I simply access the precipitation amount property on the hourly forecast. And as with everything else on WeatherKit, these properties are available via the REST API. Let me show you how to implement the previous example in REST. WeatherKit APIs are hosted at weatherkit.apple.com. So I pass that as the RESTful URL path. Next, I append parameters that represent the version of the API. This is version 2 as of this release. I provide the API, in this case weather. Following that, I add a parameter that represents the locale for which I want to fetch the data. Here, I use EN-US for American English, but I can pick from any locale supported by iOS. And if I pass in an unsupported locale, then the response defaults to EN-US. I also specify the location coordinates for which I need the data. Here, it's New York City, as in the Swift example. Finally, I specify the datasets to fetch. In this example, it is the hourly forecast. I also have the option of specifying the range of hours for which I need the forecast. In this example, and for the sake of simplicity, I restrict it to the current hour. But I can also request up to 240 hours of forecast. Note that WeatherKit defaults to 24 hours starting with the current hour if no range is specified. Also note the use of the relative hourly query parameters, which allow the Apple Weather Service to compute the exact start and end time for the forecast, based on the supply time zone. And as a reminder, you need to produce an authentication bearer in order to access the Apple Weather Service. Now, let's take a look at the result. So, I issued a GET on that URL and return an object hosted under the forecast hourly key. It contains an array of hour forecasts, and each hour forecast has several properties, including one named precipitation amount, just like the one in our Swift program. When checking the weather, we are actively looking for changing patterns because significant changes in weather can make or break plans. Learning about such changes ahead of time and in context is essential, and as such, we're adding two brand new queries to the Weather API to do just that. So now introducing changes and historical comparisons. Let's start with changes. The changes query provides upcoming changes to temperature and precipitation, including the time at which they will occur, qualifying significant upcoming fluctuations, such as increases or decreases. The Weather app uses this query today to highlight upcoming temperature changes to its users. And now, you too can use the changes query in your app. Let me show you how. Continuing with New York City as my location, I fetch the changes in weather by using the datChanges query. This returns a list of changes, from which I filter out all except those changes occurring tomorrow. Note that I extended the date struct to have isTomorrow as a property, so as to conveniently express my use case. For this next step, I map the results to an array containing only low temperature changes. Finally, if there are any changes, and those changes contain a decrease in temperature, I display an appropriate message to the user. To do this in REST, I simply specify the weather changes dataset. Note that this product always returns information, even if it's to tell you that there are no upcoming significant changes in weather. Let's take a look at an example output to crystallize our understanding. So, I just issued a GET request for weather changes and got some data back. The weather changes object is behind the weather changes key, as you would expect. It's a wrapper object for a list of changes tucked under the changes property. Each change has a start date for the change in forecast and an end date. And finally, the type of change that is expected to occur. For this first change, it means that we expect an increase in the maximum temperature at a time frame specified. Note how the change in condition could also be a decrease. Or, if no change is expected, the field would be populated with the steady marker. Changes in weather are best understood in context, so we're also introducing historical comparisons. Based on data collected over the past 50 plus years, historical comparisons lets you compare today's weather to historical averages with results ordered by significance of deviation from the mean. You can see the historical comparisons query in use today in the Weather app, where we show the deviation of today's high temperature from the historical average. This query of the Weather API is convenient to use as well. To show you how, here's another fun code snippet. In Swift, just request weather data, including the .historicalComparisons query. Remember that the list is ordered by significance of deviation from the mean. Now that we have our significant trend deviation identified, we can print it and tell the user. If you're using the REST API, just include the historical comparisons dataset. Just like in Swift, you will get a list of comparisons ordered by significance of deviation from the average. Let's take a look at the output of that request. The resulting object is stored under the historical comparisons key, and it contains a list of comparisons. Each comparison has the condition for which the trend is computed, the current value for the condition, the baseline value, which should give you context as to which direction we have been trending. The type of deviation is also listed. This corresponds to the amplitude of the deviation. In this case, the deviation is within the normal range. Other possible values for this field are higher, much higher, lower, and much lower. The baseline type represents which statistical method is used to establish a baseline. In this case, we use the mean, as opposed to something like the median value. This field value could change if we updated our statistical inference method. And finally, you get the date when we established a baseline for the computed averages for that condition. As you see, Apple Weather has introduced several enhancements to the Weather API that will allow you to get a richer picture of the current forecast, empowering you in turn to provide various slices of the forecast to users as you see fit in your app. At this time, I would like to talk about making sense of the rich weather data that you can get with WeatherKit in the global historical context. Understanding the weather in the context of the climate has become essential to any great weather experience. Beyond increasing climate awareness, a general understanding of long-term weather patterns at a location can even help with planning events or vacations far out into the future. To make this easy, we're adding an all-new statistics API that is designed to get you broad and narrow historical statistics about weather. The statistics API has two new queries, historical averages and daily summaries. With historical averages, you can fetch long-term averages for temperature and precipitation based on data recorded since January 1, 1970. These come in hourly, daily, and monthly granularities. For instance, the Weather app leverages this API to show monthly precipitation averages so that users can conveniently avoid the rainy season when planning their next great vacation. Now, I'm going to show you how you can fetch statistics data in your app as well. Here, I implemented a Swift example of fetching monthly statistics. Simply invoke the monthly statistics function on the weather service. Include your start and end month. As per the Gregorian calendar, 1 is January and 12 is December. And the type of queries that you're interested in. Here is precipitation. Now that I have the results, I group them in a dictionary keyed by the month. When using the REST API, I call the Statistics Monthly API. Passing the precipitation as my dataset, then I specify my start and end months. This returns a list of month averages. Let's take a look at the output next. So we have our monthly weather statistics object. It contains a baseline start date for the computed averages. The list of monthly averages is hosted under the months property. Since we only fetch precipitation, that's all we have. The precipitation object contains monthly averages data derived by the Apple Weather Service. Finally, the index of the concerned month is listed, 1 through 12. Using the Statistics API, you can also get a summary of the weather for any day in the past back to August 1, 2021. The summary includes high and low temperatures, as well as precipitation and snowfall amounts. The Weather app uses this to show how precipitation has accumulated over the past 30 days so as to better put today into context. Let's take a look at how to fetch this data in Swift. Here, I want to fetch the past 30 days worth of weather summary data focusing on precipitation data in Swift. I specify my date interval, which started 30 days ago and ends now. Note that 30 days ago is a custom extension that I define on date. I include precipitation as my query, and now that I have my data, I use it to inform the user. Note again that I only requested precipitation amounts in this example. If using the REST API, I call the summary daily path. Then, as in the Swift example, I filter for the precipitation dataset. Finally, I specify the start and end date for the data that I wish to receive. The results are an array of daily summaries, which normally contain temperature and precipitation data. Note that only precipitation has non-zero values since that's what we requested. As you can see, the Apple Weather Service has been investing tremendous resources building these models that allow us to put today's weather in the greater historical context. In this release, we are making the data computed by these models available to you, and we're eager to have you incorporate this wealth of new data into your app. With that said, fetching such large amounts of historical weather can be costly. So, we've also made it easy to receive weather data from our most data-intensive APIs. In this release, we're introducing support for flat buffers to make fetching weather data via WeatherKit faster than ever. Flat buffers can yield up to 25% decrease in the payload size compared to an equivalent compressed JSON. It can also yield up to 90% decrease in parse time compared to JSON. If using the Swift API, this optimization comes for free. While if using the REST API, it is optional and you can activate it by specifying an accept header. So fear not, you can fetch more data than ever while minimizing the size of the payload. And that was WeatherKit. Let's do a quick recap of what we've seen in this session. In addition to all the great features already offered, we're adding finer details to the current hourly and daily forecast. Details like cloud cover by altitude, richer precipitation data, humidity, and visibility, introducing changes and historical comparisons queries, an all-new statistics API, and bringing support for flat buffers. We're excited to see how you'll innovate with these enhancements. If you have already used WeatherKit, think about enriching your forecast with additional data points provided by this release. Or you can keep your users informed about significant weather changes. You also have a wealth of historical data at your fingertips, which you can use to give your users a broader perspective on today's weather. If you're using the REST API, please consider taking advantage of the new flat buffer response. If you have never used WeatherKit, please consider watching Meet WeatherKit from WWDC 2022, then give it a try today. Thank you for watching.